Thank you very much for this nice introduction. First of all, it's a pleasure for me to be here in front of you today for a number of reasons. First of all, I also graduated from Polytechnic School in Brussels at that time, so it was not such a big one as Torino or Milan as you all graduated from, but still Polytechnic studies are great studies, so I congratulate you on your choice. And for me, it's a pleasure to be here because of that reason. Secondly, it's always, of course, a big pleasure to talk in front of young people, in front of a young audience like you all, who are very motivated and who are standing in front of a very challenging task, I think. The other thing is, of course, that you're in front of some challenging tasks here, and challenging 2 years. And throughout my presentation, which has the title here, Challenges of a Long-Duration Space Mission and the Role of ISS, the ISS actually is the International Space Station that is now orbiting the Earth, and 6 people are permanently living and working in space every day. So I was one of them last year. Of course, the big voyage that you see there is the voyage to Mars. We are not there yet today. I don't know exactly when we will get there, but I hope that some of you might help us in getting there. But you will see that some of these challenges are exactly the same challenges that you will face in the next 2 years. And it's not on this title because I did not know it before, but I was here as well this morning listening to the presentations. And I will for sure introduce this because if you talk about innovation, if you talk about passion, if you talk about ethics, if you talk about international environment, if you talk about multidisciplinary, these of course are all keywords that are very well applicable as well to this endeavor. And I'll try to come to that in my presentation. After the presentation, I will have a small video for you in which I will try to show you how life and working today is in space, in the International Space Station. I was there for 6 months, and I will try to give you a flavor of all the tasks that we need to do there, to put this a little bit in a different perspective. In this first presentation, I will only ask questions, because I'm a customer, I'm an astronaut, so I'm not that smart. I'm just doing things what I'm told to do, but I can ask good questions. After me, Marie Antoinette will come. She's from industry. She has all the answers. So that is. So she will give answers to some of those questions, and then we still have two distinguished speakers who will put us a little bit more in a complex environment and also in the political environment. How we then can the questions, the solutions, how we can then make those two work. So that is a bit the overview of our presentation this afternoon, I think. So introduction. You see there a couple of slides. You have engineering on the left, but on the right side you have people. We tend to spend a lot of time in engineering and optimizing our engineering solutions, getting in friction in like these rasters that you see, 2% or 3% less is already a big achievement because you will consume less fuel, you will have less maintenance and whatever. But you see there the diversity of the people that you see on the right-hand side of your slide. We don't spend an awful lot of effort, usually, in our communities to reduce the friction between people. Certainly not when the people are from a very diverse background. And this is certainly that we will need to do if we want to have a global challenge, if we want to fly to space as well, on all levels, between the engineers, between the astronauts, between the politicians, between the diplomats. So this is a very big effort that we will need to place if we want to go beyond low Earth orbit and explore our solar system. And so the two aspects that you see here, on one hand, the engineering that we will have to manage, but also otherwise the people skills that we have to manage, is something that will be very important. And it will be the same for you, because you have a lot of foreign students here in the school. So if eventually you end up in a project with 6 people from very different cultural backgrounds, you will also have to manage, and you have heard this already today, you will also have to manage your people skills. So mission to Mars, what does it mean? Well, first of all, it will be an international endeavor. Today, the International Space Station, we have 5 partners. In a mission to Mars, I think, but this is a very personal opinion, it will be much more. Probably we have India, we will have China, South Korea, South Africa. So it will probably be a more global mission that we will have to undertake. With, again, very different nationalities like you have here in your courses. If we go to Mars with current technology of today, it would mean a voyage of 3 years. So how do we select the people that will go to Mars? Do we select 3 men and 3 women? So it might be a solution. If we select, let's say, 6 men, we talked this morning as well about ethics. Would that be ethical that we send envoys of humankind for the first time to Mars and we only select men? Which kind of message would that give to the societies? Probably not a good one. Same thing if we only would send women. But if you send 3 men and 3 women, which is a better message, what do you do if during those 3 years where the people can only communicate between themselves, what do you do if some relationships forms? Well, okay, maybe not too bad for the ones who have a relationship, maybe not for the ones who can't form a relationship. Or what happens if a relationship breaks up in the spaceship? You just can't walk out of the door. Eh? So these are things that today we have not mastered. So we need to start thinking about that. I know it's not engineering per se, but maybe we can have engineering solutions that bring this a little bit closer. The different backgrounds. You have here students from engineering, from also architecture, which have different backgrounds, different thinking processes. Think about the backgrounds that we will take to Mars. Probably engineers for the spaceship, military people for the commander's role, maybe, maybe not. Doctors, scientists, how will we do that? And it's a 3-year mission, so these people will have to live in a small tin can for 3 years without being able to communicate to anybody else except themselves. So imagine that it's, you will see in the next 2 years that intercultural differences can play a role, but at the end of the evening you can walk out and you can go to the pub and have a beer. Those people, they can't, of course. So some questions. Again, I'm only asking questions. As I said, Marie Antoinette will give all the answers. Selection of the crew. How are you going to select the crew? Do you want a crew that is really very well selected together, so you know exactly that the personalities go together very well? It's not how it's happening today. Also in your school, you will be selected for a project, but you will all give your individual preferences for a project, and at the end, you will end up with the people you end up with. So you will have to work with them. Who will select this crew? If it's an international crew, will there be one responsible? No, probably Europe will say, well, we want this person to fly. Okay, and then the US will say, we want this person to fly. So the 6 people, like a little bit by you and your project, will have to come together and then will have to start working out their differences. What will be the basis for such a selection? Today we don't really have an idea how we can see that people for so long can work together and live together. And then the training. Today, the training for a mission to the ISS of 6 months takes 2.5 years minimum. In my case, I was also a backup. It took 4 years. 4 years of training. 4 years of training. The amount of knowledge that you need to acquire is huge during those 4 years. Imagine that we don't go 400 kilometers away from our planet, not 400,000 like to the moon, but millions of kilometers away, totally isolated. What kind of training will we give those people? What knowledge do they need to have? How can we build systems that require that they don't have to spend 10 years in training and that they have to be super knowledgeable in order to make the mission a success? No, we need to build systems so that the people can train 1 or 2 years, take the spacecraft and have a successful mission. So this is will be a very important engineering solution. Communications, again, you will only be able to talk internally with the crew. You will not be able, due to the distance from the Earth, the time delay will be 5 to 20 minutes, depending where Mars is, somewhere in relation to the Earth. So if I would speak to you here and I say, good afternoon, it would take 20 minutes to reach you, and then you can talk back to me and say, good afternoon, Frank, and then it would be 40 minutes later. This is not a conversation, of course. So the only communication will be internally, but then how do you organize the communication with the external world? Video messages, email type, remote email, what solutions can we find? Weight will be extremely important, so we need to find solutions that keep the spacecraft as tiny as possible. But how do you deal with privacy in such cases? Already in the space station, we have very little privacy. Our crew quarters is limited to 1 meter by 1 meter by 2 meters high. This is the space of privacy that we have in the space station. All the rest is open. How do you deal with that for 3 years? if you're away, not for 6 months. Operations, today in the space station, almost everything is operated from the ground. Here in Alenia, we have a control center that operates parts of the space station. There are control centers all over the world. There are thousands of people supporting the astronaut in his daily tasks. They can do that because they have a direct link and there is no time delay. So if something goes wrong, they immediately see it and they can react. Again, here it's not possible. We will be remote. It's impossible that they will be able to do all the operations from the ground. So how do we do that? And another aspect, psychologically for the crew, today I feel very safe in the space station because I have my lifeboat, my Soyuz, which is attached to the space station. If something goes wrong, fire, depressurization, I go to my Soyuz, I close the hatch, I push the button, and in 3 hours I'm back on the ground. Not bad for a safety solution. How will you organize this if you go to Mars? You have no return capability. Or if we want a return capability, it will be an impossible engineering solution maybe, because it will be way too big and will way too expensive. So how do we deal with that? So again, I'm only asking questions. We are in an academic world here, so just to have your mind thinking about the challenges that are out there for us. Sensory information. Today when we go to the space station, we can see the Earth. You see a picture there below, beautiful planet. You feel connected. I'm from Belgium. Every time that we flew over Belgium and I had time, I was at the window with the camera, I took pictures. I felt connected to my family. When you're there, in Mars, you will not see anything anymore. It will be totally black around the entire spacecraft. In a big part of the voyage, you will neither see the Earth, neither Mars. How will we as people deal with that? We don't know. How will all these other things, feeling, again, it's maybe a little bit controversial, but one of the things I missed most during my 6 month space flight was my family, my wife and my kids, because you're used to have, as human beings, we need close physical contact with people. That's part of our psychological well-being. How do you organize this in a spacecraft with six people if you're away for 3 years without then also going that it can be misinterpreted with all the cultural differences, it can raise to conflicts and whatever. So it's an aspect that we also need to think about. As engineers, we tend to forget that. As human beings, we can't. And this is part of your job as well, if I understood very well in your academy here, is that you don't always need to think only about the engineering solutions. There is also the ethics, there is the human aspect, there is the sustainability, there is the environment. So we live in a much more complex world today and we need to take this into account in our solutions. Some of the solutions, you see here just some pictures, different crew quarters that you can have, on communications, food can be a big and important factor, food engineering on board, that you can at least have a little bit of luxury, entertainment systems on board, what kind of entertainment systems will we take to counteract all these things, so there might be some solutions. As a conclusion of this first view graph, yes, indeed, we have a lot of challenges ahead of us. The ISS, the International Space Station, can it serve as a test bed? Yes, it can, because some of the technologies we can test there, some of the principles we can test there. We live in microgravity for 6 months now without any problem. We are isolated as well in a small environment for 6 months, so it can be used as a test bed for sure, and we should use it. It's one of the big principles for the next 10 years of utilization of the ISS, is to utilize it really to test principles, to test technologies, to test ideas of how we can then go further beyond low Earth orbit to the Moon or to Mars. But as I said, there are also a lot of limitations that we have in the ISS, because it's not completely representative of what we will do ultimately. And so the forward thinking, the ideas to go think outside the box and to see what kind of other solutions can we approach will be extremely important. And so that's one of your jobs, of course, of the future, if you decide to work in this area, is to come up with these type of solutions as an engineer or as an architect. So that concludes this part of the presentation. I will now go into a little bit more lively event, I would say, and give you an overview of what we today do in the ISS, and you can relate it to the things that I have told you, what we need or what the challenges are for a space flight to Mars. So international cooperation is also a fact in the ISS. It's not a global cooperation. We don't have so many countries as you have present here in your Alta Scuola, but there is still Canada, ESA, 10 member states, 10 European member states are part of the ISS, JAXA, which is our Japanese colleagues, NASA, the US, and Roscosmos. So you see, it's not global, but we have at least Asia, we have Russia, we have the US, we have European culture. So it's a fair mix of different cultures that we have on board of the space station. Expedition 20 and 21 is the expedition to which I participated in the space station. We have logos, of course, if you have all have logos from the Alta Scuola, we also have one. Six stars, because we have six people on board of the ISS for the first time during this expedition. And on the lower hand, also kids, because exploration ultimately will do it for the next generations, for humankind. So the future, the children are very important. I'm also a UNICEF ambassador, and we will come to that a little bit later. Here you see the rollout of the vehicles that we use today. Progress vehicle, Soyuz vehicle is this one which I flew. This is the shuttle, space shuttle vehicle. Nicole Stott came with us for 4 months. This is the crew I flew with. This is the shuttle crew leaving for their vehicle. Lots of smiling faces, of course, because if you have prepared for 3 to 4 years to fly to the ISS, and then finally the big day is there, and you can sit on top of one of these rockets, you're very happy. On the other hand, there is a little bit of stress, not a little bit, quite some stress, of course, because if you don't are stressed, if you sit on top of those rockets, you don't really know what you're doing. By the way, if you look to the right-hand side, the American flag on the rocket there, this is where the crew is sitting. All the rest is just engines and fuel. And this all just comes back to Earth. So you see that the vehicle really where we are surviving in is very tiny. Nicole is coming here to the ISS after 2 days of rendezvous orbiting. The Soyuz is here approaching to the International Space Station. This was our vehicle. Bob, our Canadian friend, my Canadian hero, enters laughing the space station. Bob started laughing when he entered the space station, and he stopped laughing when he left the space station. So you will see it in all the videos. He's always with a big smile on his face. A lot of smiling faces as well when we have guests in the space station. Again, we have regular guests, so it's not like we are isolated for 6 months. Always very nice when we have guests arriving. It's like you're at home and you have friends arriving. It's also very nice. I can assure you, if they have been there for 10 days and they have messed up your entire space station, you're also very happy that they leave again and you see the same smiling faces. So it's also a little bit like at home, if you have people staying over too long and they work on your nerves, you're also happy that they leave again. Here you see EVA, the most dangerous activity on the space station, also so the most challenging from a psychological and physical point of view. If you do an EVA, you're about 8 to 10 hours in the suit that you see there, which is actually a mini spaceship that is built and engineered. It's very difficult to work in that suit because, of course, it's under pressure, so you have very difficulties of moving. You see here the crew members need to breathe pure oxygen for a number of hours before they go out of the door. A space communicator, because all the tasks are very, very narrowly scheduled during a spacewalk. Everything needs to work on an optimal basis, so you have people inside that help you organizing your tasks outside. And then finally, if after 6 or 7 hours out of the door, they come back into the vehicle, everybody is very happy. Another important operational task is robotics. Since EVAs are very difficult to plan and to execute, we try to do as much as we can with robotics. Here you see the Japanese robotic arm installing a payload at the outside of the International Space Station. This was an Earth observation payload, for example, that was installed. And you do all this through systems from inside the vehicle. You see here myself and Nicole in one of the most important operational tasks that we had for the mission. This is the Japanese vehicle. If we talk about international cooperation in the space station, this is a Japanese cargo vehicle, flew for the first time. It's crabbled in mid-space. You see that the arm there is approaching it and it's going to attach it by a Canadian-built robot arm. The arm was operated by an American astronaut. The vehicle and the space station itself was operated by myself as a European astronaut. Our safety officer was Bob Tursk, our Canadian guy, and this all happened under the command of a Russian commander. So international cooperation in space is not just a couple of words. It's really day-to-day operations, not only in space, but also all the ground centers on the ground every day need to consult, need to agree on plans, need to build plans out together. So it's really real out there. And you will see this as well in your future career. The world is really global. We are not anymore confined to our little countries as we were in the past. Another important task that we have on the space station is logistics. This is actually an Italian-built module here in Alenia, the MPLM. About 50% of the pressurized volume of the space station today is built here in Italy by Alenia, by the company of Marie Antoinette. That's why she can provide you later on with all the solutions, because they are extremely smart people and extremely good people. Here you see myself working with Christer Fuglsang, my Swedish colleague who came and joined me for 2 weeks. Logistics, as you see in space, is sometimes a little bit easier than here on the Earth. We don't need to use our feet for transportation. Here we have a progress vehicle. Very important as well, the progress vehicle, it docks automatically. Actually, like our European ATV, we have an automated transfer vehicle in Europe. It's going to launch next week, Wednesday. It's going to bring 8 tons of cargo to the International Space Station. It's also going to dock automatically, much like this progress vehicles. The progress vehicles have the good characteristic that people on the ground can have late access, meaning that the Russians, ground crew, couple of hours before the flight can still stuff things in the vehicle. So they normally put in like apples or oranges, some fresh fruit for the astronauts, because of course we don't have fridges on board, so we only eat out of tin cans and packs. For some reason, the Russians also put in garlic and onions. Don't ask me why, but that's a cultural difference. So we learned together with our Russian colleagues to eat raw onions and raw garlic on the space station. This is Nicole working on a mice drawer. We also go to space to do science. We had the operational part, we had the logistics, cargo vehicles, now we have the scientific part. Science is very important on board of the space station. We did about 1,000 hours of science on board. Here you see me working with water. Water is also very important in space. For our health, of course, we need sufficient water to drink, but it also needs to be clean, clear, without microbia. You also saw me there wearing a UNICEF t-shirt. It's because I'm also a goodwill ambassador for UNICEF. And during the mission, we had a joint program between ESA and UNICEF around wash, water sanitation and hygiene, because a lot of children today, people today on the Earth, do not have access to clear drinking water. And because of that, they don't have access to education like you have. And this is really a disaster. And we are not talking about a few. We are talking about 1 billion out there. So the numbers are huge. So that's why we also set up this campaign. And you see that even if you have a very high technical job, it doesn't prevent you from also having some ethical aspects of your job and from combining these two. And more companies and people start doing this. It's what is called ethical enterprising, ethical engineering. So we also try to do this in space. Here you see satellites that are flying together in formation, will become very important. Nicole is working on a furnace to do some material science results. Speaking about water in space, we recycle about 70% of the water in our in the space station, meaning that the coffee that we all had now for after lunch will be the same coffee that we drink tomorrow, and the same coffee that we drink the next day, and we will drink the same coffee for the next 6 months, because all our urine is recycled. So it's not only your coffee that you drink, it's also the coffee from your crewmates that you drink the next day. So it's also a psychological factor. This is plant growth. Biology experiments is also what we do a lot, because of course if we want to fly to Mars, we will not only have to recycle urine, we have to recycle everything, all the human waste, and so plant biology and life support systems will become very important. And also here Alenia here in Turin has a lot of expertise in that domain. Something else we do in space is sports. Microgravity is bad for our body. here gravity, our muscles develop, our bone density develops because of gravity. We don't have it in space, so we do to do a lot of sports. Here, of course, we're joking around. It's also very fun to be in space. I admit it. I had a lot of fun as well. Bob is doing exercising here on the ARAT. It's a fitness machine that was brand new when we arrived. It's really working great for us. You see me cycling there in the back. Behind Nicole, and here you see Tim cycling, no saddle because there is no gravity, so we don't need to sit on a bike, we can just float on the bike. But of course if we want to run, we can't float, we can't run floating, so we need a harness, we need bungees to keep us on the treadmill. But nevertheless, it's always easy to get your feet up a little bit when you're in microgravity, so resting is usually not so much of a problem. And push-ups is also not so much of a problem in space as you can imagine. And this is the result of our 2.5 hours of sports every single day. I think Nicole will take us here through a guided tour through the space station. This is the Japanese module where we do most of the Japanese experiments. They also have a small airlock, so we can also use it to transfer things from inside the space station to outside the space station. Here you have the Columbus module with the Belgian flag. Columbus module is very important. It's our European laboratory on space. It's basically the facility that is used most to do science on the space station. We have more than 10 science facilities inside the Columbus module. It's a world-class laboratory, and it was also built here in Alenia in big part, so we are very happy to have this piece of hardware on board of the space station. It's there where I spend I would say 80% of my time in the Columbus module. We're here floating from the American part, American segment, to the Russian segment. Two space stations basically made it together because we operate as one crew, but the systems are very different. For example, on the American side, you have 120 volts. On the Russian side, you have 28 volts. The water on the American side is not the same water as the Russian. The water on the Russian side. So also there, all these engineering solutions need to be found. Max is flying here in the Russian command module, from which the space station, the entire space station, can be commanded. And this is really the command post. And on the left side there, you see some cameras. Cameras are very important. I already said it during the previous presentation. To do Earth observation. It's really wonderful to look at our Earth. We do this for a number of reasons. Scientific research, climate change. Since 10 years now, we are taking pictures from orbit. And there you can see at the horizon a very thin blue line. This is basically the thickness of our atmosphere seen from space. In a beautiful day like today on Torino, you look up and you think that the blue sky goes forever. Here from space, you see that this blue sky is actually just a very thin layer. So it also makes you very well aware of all the environmental challenges that we have ahead of us with this huge population on Earth. The other aspect, not scientific aspect, but the other aspect of observation from space, here we have Paris, for example, is psychological support. It's one of the biggest psychological support tools that you have on the space station, is being able to look out the window and being able to take pictures from all kinds of places on Earth, the most beautiful things you can see from there. This is Houston, where we did a lot of our training, and a lot of my American friends are from. Probably the most beautiful things you can see are coral reefs from space, with all the shades of blue in the ocean. It's really fantastic. Sometimes we also see disasters, of course. Here you have some forest fires in Canada that are there. Palm Island, man-made island, also technology, is also architecture, so something that you can also think about. And also technology and architecture, a lot of architecture is, of course, Venice with the Grand Canale. You probably here in Italy all know that. But we also live in space, so normal things that we do here on the ground, we also need to do in space. For example, cutting our hair is one of the activities. Roman does not have too much confidence as a crew member, as you can see there. Nicole wanted to be part of the group, again, psychological effect, so she wanted her hair to be cut, so we cut 1 centimeter of her hair as well. And Jeff also, his last hair wanted to be, I think, removed. All these kind of activities which have to do with living in space, like this, like cleaning the space station, for example, are usually done Saturdays and Sundays. Here you have a very other important aspect, food. We have a lot of good food now on the space station, including European food, French food, German food, Italian food. In space, you can play with your food, so that's very nice. You can't do it here. It's part of the things, I think, that were set. So don't get in the disciplinary committee because you played with your food in some occasions. But on space, you can do it. We had basically all our lunches, breakfast, lunches, and dinners together in order to make a group cohesion between our team and between our crew, and to make sure that we will not allow conflicts to occur. We also celebrated Halloween. Tim is demonstrating that a Spider-Man does exist. This is an important moment for Europe. It's the moment that I took commandership of the space station. First time a non-Russian or a non-American took the commandership. Of course, I was only able to do that because my predecessors who flew before me, like Thomas Reiter, Leopold Erhard, some of the Italian astronauts, Paolo Nespoli, did excellent jobs in their tasks, in the careers that they did. And so gradually we built up a reputation within the European Astronaut Corps and within the European Space Agency in operating the ISS. And it's only because you build up expertise, you build up knowledge, you build up operational capability, and you build up credibility that of course you can get this higher level function. So I was just there at the right time, at the right moment. But it's really a success of the European Space Agency and all the industries and organizations that are associated with it. Here you see the day of departure. It's always a little bit sad to have to leave this facility if you have worked there for 6 months, lived there as well for 6 months. If this is your home, your apartment for 6 months, you can imagine that it's sad to leave it behind. It's also sad to leave your friends behind there because we really became very good friends on the space station. But it was also time to come home because, of course, real life is here on Earth. Our families are here on Earth. Our kids, my wife was here on Earth. And they have supported us not only through those 6 months that we were in space, but also the 4 years that before that I was in training, that I was traveling all over the world between Russia, the States, Japan, Canada, and Europe, living in hotels 4 years in a row, and then 6 months in the space station. So it was a lot harder for them. We were living our dream, and they supported our dream. So a lot of our thanks, of course, go to all of them. And then the final picture of the crew with which I stayed 187 days in space. On the top right, you have Bob Tursk, my Canadian hero. Without him, my space flight would certainly not have been the success it was. On the left, you see Roman Romanenko, my Russian colleague, Russian commander of the Soyuz, second generation cosmonaut. His father was also a cosmonaut. I think he was born in space. It was amazing. He could do everything from the first time right with so much ease in space. It was really amazing. Never seen somebody work like Roman. He's already assigned for his second long duration space flight in 2 years. In 2013, he will fly again for 6 months to the space station. And on the bottom, myself, who was very honored to be able to deliver this speech to you today. Thank you very much.